Right, we would like to get started in a few minutes. We're just we'll wait about 3 or 4 minutes to see if we can get another member to get our quorum established. Otherwise, we will begin as a subcommittee in deference to everyone who is here. So we'll get started in a couple minutes. All right, we'd like to welcome everybody to local government. Before we get started, we would like to establish the quorum. So if the clerk would please call the roll.
Smythe.
Here.
Alejo.
Here.
Bradford.
Here.
Campos.
Here.
Davis. Gordon.
Here.
Wisso. Knight. Norby.
Okay. Thank you. We have established a quorum. Just a brief housekeeping notes. If anyone is here for item number 13, AB 943, that has been pulled from today's hearing. We do have one item on consent, which is item number 9, AB 484. We'd be happy to take a motion on that. I know, Mr. Bradford, we have to help them out a little bit. But all right, we do have a motion and a second on consent. If you would please call the roll.
Smythe.
Aye.
Smythe, aye. Alejo?
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford?
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos?
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis? Gordon?
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso? Knight? Norby?
Thank you. Consent calendar is out. We will start, as we do, our custom is to go with sign-in order. The first item, or first member to sign in, is Mr. Bell. With two items, item number AB 57 and AB 129, what is your pleasure? We will take AB 57 first, and again, for those that are new to the committee, we will allow two primary witnesses on both sides, and then go to the add-ons after that. So, Mr. Bell, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'll be very brief in my presentation and turn it over to my witnesses. AB 57 adds two extra seats to the Metropolitan Transportation Commission in a nine-county Bay Area. One seat's appointed to the mayor of San Jose, another seat the mayor of Oakland. Support for AB 57 has grown since the bill was introduced. Both the Contra Costa and the Metropolitan Transportation, both Contra Costa County Metropolitan Transportation Commissioners now support the measure. And the Vice Chair of the Commission from Contra Costa, Amy Worth, testified in the Transportation Committee in support of this bill. This has unanimous support in the Assembly Transportation Commission, and we have witnesses. I'll turn it over to our witnesses, Mr. Chairman, and ask your support for the bill.
Thank you. First witness.
Mr. Chairman, members, my name is Randy Rentschler. I represent the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. We are the sponsor of this bill. We urge you to vote yes on this bill. This issue has been a longstanding issue for the commission that I work for that represents the San Francisco Bay Area. Over the many years since the commission was created in the early 1970s, the growth across the Bay Area has been a bit uneven. The counties of Santa Clara and Alameda have grown much faster. With the passage of Senate Bill 375 last year, or a couple of years back, by this body, there's a real challenge in California in order to meet the demands of global climate change. On the transportation side, that means we need to live a little smarter. The Bay Area needs to house the people that work there, and the big cities in the Bay Area, which are San Francisco, San Jose, and Oakland, are the places where all the transit ridership is, where the transit ridership will be into the future, where the airports and seaports are, where the congestion is, where the air quality demands are as well. These cities share a great deal in common. San Jose and San Francisco are partners in delivering high-speed rail to the citizens of this state. For all of these reasons, we believe that the big cities should be at the table on the Transportation Commission so we can find the consensus that we need in the Bay Area in order to meet the needs of our citizens. I thank you for your time, and we urge you to vote yes on this bill.
Thank you. Next witness.
Yes, thank you. Mr. Chair, members, Roxanne Meller representing the Mayor, City Council, City of San Jose. As was indicated to you by the representative of MTC, we believe the passage of this legislation and the adjustments in the governing board, which the existing governing board has existed since 1970, will benefit the entire region with regard to decision making, whether it is as relates to implementation of transportation planning, mobility, also as indicated, implementation of 375. We think it is exceedingly important. This is an opportunity for strong partnership between San Francisco, San Jose, and Oakland, and to assure that the best possible work product comes from the decisive decisions which must be made on the future of the Bay Area. BART to San Jose, high-speed rail to the region, to the north, concluding at San Francisco. All of these are important challenges that we all face together. So we come today to urge your support to provide balance and credibility and the opportunity to work together in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. If we could ask the rest of the witnesses in support, if you could come forward, keep your remarks relatively brief.
Good afternoon. My name is Scott Haywood. I'm from the Santa Clara Valley Transportation Authority in Santa Clara County, and we would respectfully urge your support and passage of this today. Thank you.
My name is Larry Reed. I'm president of the Oakland City Council. I'm here to voice the City of Oakland support and ask you for an aye vote on this bill.
Thank you.
Michael Radigan on behalf of the Board of Supervisors, Santa Clara County, here in support.
Thank you.
Ahmad Chapman on behalf of Transform California, voicing our support.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Thank you. Witnesses in opposition, please. And
good afternoon. Thank you. Jason Elliott, representing the Mayor's Office of San Francisco and the San Francisco Board of Supervisors. Thank you for allowing us to address you today. We come in opposition to AB 57. The speakers before us presented a very real issue, the need for potentially realigning the way that the MTC is governed and how the seats are apportioned. The City of San Francisco, which is in formal opposition, although is not reflected in the file, will be submitting the resolution that the board passed several months ago. San Francisco simply believes that there needs to be a consensus approach on how to take a look at these issues of reapportioning MTC seats. The proposal before you today does not have unanimous support at the MTC and among Bay Area counties. It was not given a public process. And while there is a very real need to potentially think about how to reapportion MTC seats, this proposal does not represent a unanimous approach, and we don't think that it's appropriate to ask the state legislature to act as a referee in this discussion that we still need to continue to have in a very real way at the local level. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
José Luis Moscovich, the Executive Director of the San Francisco Transportation Authority, and our position of opposition is included in your record, Mr. Chairman. The Transportation Authority obviously seconds the Mayor's Office position on this. We believe that there's an opportunity for a very fruitful partnership with all counties in the Bay Area, and that SB 375 provides a great opportunity and incentive for the region to rethink its governance. But it needs to be doing that in a more in-depth way that takes into account the needs of the urban core in all of the constituent parts of the region. And the authority's position is that we need to all engage in that and come back to you with a consensus position on what that shape of the table should be.
Thank you. Mr. Amiano.
Thank you very much, colleagues. I know this is a somewhat unusual situation, and my esteemed colleague, Mr. Bell, and I work very well together. We're basically playing intramural ball right now. Fortunately, it's not football, because I think I would be losing. But I don't want to lose this. I don't want Mr. Bell to lose this either. But I do think that this is not the the way to represent the MTC. Mr. Bell served on the MTC honorably and was very productive, and I had the honor of meeting him there, and then I served on it for a number of years. This issue, as far as I know, as far as the city knows, was never really vetted. There never was much public hearing on it. I do think we can make this a win-win, but unfortunately, I'm here today to ask you to not vote on this measure, and that this does return to where it should be, home base, at where we could work this out. As you know, Mr. Bell is a very, very wonderful representative of his district, and I'd like to think that I do the same for San Francisco. Rather than fighting this out on the state level, I would much prefer to do it with a level playing field with local advocates and and work this out. In my mind, that's always preferable. So thank you for your attention, and I would ask that for a no vote.
Thank you. And for all future witnesses in opposition, if you would just please now state your name and position. Obviously, we broke the rule as a courtesy to a colleague, but everyone else, we ask that you please just now state your name and your position. So any other representatives in opposition to the bill, please come forward.
Did you say in favor or did you say?
In opposition.
Oh, no.
Thank you, Mr. Swanson. Thank you for checking in.
Foul. Foul. You know, they both outweigh me, but it's not a reason to vote for it.
Yeah.
You're cute. And you're young.
Okay, wait. I need to get control here, everybody. No, I'm just kidding. All right. Again, any other? Yes. Ms. Ma, please, if you can, you can use the.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair and members. I respectfully oppose this bill. There are nine counties that have voting rights on the MTC. It has been in existence for I'm not sure how many years. There hasn't been a problem with the changing the voting requirements. San Francisco has more ridership coming in and out of the city every day, and we have not asked for another seat at the table. And if Alameda and Santa Clara would like an extra seat. Well, San Francisco would like an extra seat also. We just think that that's fair if we're going to start talking about who gets voting rights. But we feel that the MTC is very, very important in terms of the regional transportation system, and it's been fine. I don't understand why certain members are asking for additional seats, but San Francisco would like another seat too. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Ma. Again, any other witnesses in opposition? Any tweeners? Any other legislators? Mr. Swanson, you want to check in for
it? Well, just because, just make sure the record was clear, I am actually supporting my colleague's bill, and I think that it's just a question of representation. We're not trying to take anything away from anyone that already has a seat like San Francisco. What we're trying to do is make sure that representation in a growing metropolitan area is accurate and specific, and so we ask for your aye vote to move the matter forward.
Thank you. I'm going to, at this point, close testimony from witnesses and open it up to the members. Just a question first, Mr. Bell. I mean, can you address kind of the question about why the legislature is taking this? I think, you know, because the committee, you know, usually wants to have things, you know, worked out at the local level and that we're not weighing in, you know, picking one side or another. And so if you can maybe just address those points that were raised.
Well, I most certainly will. This issue has been discussed, as you can see by your staff report, many times over the years. And at the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. The Metropolitan Transportation Commission is the regional transportation agency in the Bay Area, and it represents nine counties. Approximately 7 million people or so live in the nine counties. The representation of the two largest counties, Alameda and Santa Clara County, have been the same, the actual equal number of representatives as San Francisco and Contra Costa and San Mateo County. And just to give you an idea of what happened here, this has been debated for many years, and the population gap is getting wider and wider and wider. So it's time to look at this. The Metropolitan Transportation Commission itself, Mr. Chairman, actually had a hearing. They have a discussion. It was a public-involved discussion over several meetings, and the commission voted to support and recommend this change that I'm now presenting in legislation on behalf of the Nine County Metropolitan Transportation Commission. Now, I have to say the vote was not unanimous. San Francisco, of course, did vote against this. They have 800 or so thousand people in San Francisco. Santa Clara County, 805,000 people in San Francisco. Santa Clara County right now has 1.781 million people. Alameda County has 1.5 million people. The federal law that governs metropolitan transportation planning organizations does say that the Voting Rights Act has to be observed in the reapportionment of commissions. In terms of creating equity in terms of representation, I think there's a issue here of fair representation. So the commission actually recommended, after much discussion and public input, adding a seat for the city of San Jose mayor and the city of Oakland mayor, and as a fair way of adjusting. There's also, I point out, two seats that are sort of at large in the Bay Area. The two at large seats are appointed by ABAG and the Bay Area Conservation Development Commission. Those seats under the statute that we're creating, in order to establish some form of equity, have not, under the statute we're proposing, will not be allowed to be appointed by Alameda or Santa Clara County, but the remaining seven counties will decide who the representation for those two at-large seats among the seven remaining counties. So in order to point that out, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to point out that one of the seats, the Bay Area Conservation Development Commission, has almost, in I think the entire history of it since the commission was started, was a San Francisco delegate. So in effect right now, San Francisco has three seats on the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. And Santa Clara County actually only has two seats at this point. I did propose over the years to Mr. Amiano, Mr. Swanson, and I have looked at appointing the commission in other forms, but this is the most acceptable to the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. So I'm presenting this bill on behalf of the 9-county Bay Area Metropolitan Transportation Commission after their discussion.
Mr. Weso.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate, thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate you asking the question, clarifying why this is before us, and if it's truly our responsibility to, you know, adjudicate this matter, I'm willing to work with the sponsor of the bill to create a bill that's truly representative of the taxpayers, and I think that's very important. I wanted to ask whether the MTC uses a weighted vote way of getting support for any measures. So, and I'll just give you an example. In San Diego, we have a seat per jurisdiction, and each jurisdiction gets a weighted vote as well. So there, every time everybody votes, there's one that is calculates the jurisdiction's vote and another one that calculates the weighted vote simultaneously. And for a measure to pass, both the weighted vote and the representative vote has to pass or get more than 50% of the vote. So on the one hand, you, instead of debating over seats, because as the years go by, you're going to have fluctuations, you'll have, the MTC will have the opportunity on their own accord to amend the weighted vote as population fluctuates so that we don't have to come to the assembly or to the legislature in the future to, you know, adjudicate these matters where they could be decided at the local level through a weighted vote. Have you considered that as an option to create a more democratic form of representation?
Assembly member, it's been discussed at great length, and unlike the model in San Diego, the commission does not work under a weighted voting situation. Now, there are some places in the Bay Area that do, but we do not, and again, it's been discussed at great length.
Would the author be willing to consider that as an option in this bill? Do you feel that this is the only viable solution? Are you willing to consider a weighted vote as a means of creating a...
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I would respond by saying the commission in its discussion said this is really, after all the permutations and debates, the only acceptable option. And if this option is
the MTC,
not, yes.
So the MTC is in support of this plan.
The MTC is the sponsor of this plan and has given the plan to me to introduce as legislation with my colleagues. So,
the weighted vote concept is not something you're willing to entertain.
No, they discussed that issue fully, and that's not something they will they looked at that, and it's become too difficult for them to accomplish.
Well, why is it difficult? Can anybody respond as to the difficulty? I mean, it could be done on a the point system is based on population. So it's simply in setting up an internal voting mechanism that would be a representative at the same time give everybody a seat at the table.
The concept is fully understood. They understand it completely.
Okay.
It is not a new thing to them. As the person who represents the commission legislatively, I would say to you is that the compromise before you, which was discussed at great length by each of them, essentially has a give and take from all parties. There's no question that at 1.8 million people, Santa Clara County is by far the largest as compared to, let's say, 800,000 in the city of San Francisco. But we also have small counties such as Napa County that have very little population, and small counties such as Sonoma County, which have very large geography, but again, rather small population. Those smaller counties would feel significantly disadvantaged by the way that it works in San Diego. So again, our commission's representation was created by the state legislature back in the 1970s. We are here before you because we have to be, in order to change it. So when it comes to this issue of population, the compromise was discussed, and this is the one that's before you that was acceptable to the commission overall, with, of course, the city of San Francisco not supporting. But what we have is the support of the commission, but they would not support that item, and they would not seek for this bill to advance under it.
And I would like to hear arguments as to why this is more democratic or more truly representative of all the stakeholders than a weighted vote.
I think what I would say to you, sir, is that this is the thing that they could agree on. This is what they could agree
but
on.
But is it the best approach?
I would say to you, this is what they could agree on.
they debated it for about 3 years.
Mr. Amiano, do you want to respond?
Thank you for hearing us out again. You know, in terms of the population, again, as Assemblywoman Ma pointed out, we get hundreds of thousands of people from those areas into our areas. There is redistricting coming up, so I don't think basing something on population is actually visionary. As a matter of fact, we may have to come back to the table and waste your valuable time. This is a local issue. Yeah, it's been around for a long time, but we've never really reached consensus on this issue. This decision belongs locally, with San Francisco being given equality in the discussion. I really feel that the committee is put in an awkward position, and I certainly respect that, and my colleagues and other colleagues at the MTC. But I think this is the wrong place and the wrong time.
Mr. Leo.
Question and then a comment. First of all, does the MTC, are there two vacancies currently for the city of San Francisco?
Currently there is one, sir.
One. Yep. And why hasn't that been filled?
Well,
we have a big debate about just needing the seats.
I can only speak to the facts. And the facts are that in the city of San Francisco, the mayor of the city has an appointment and the Board of Supervisors has an appointment. The mayor made his appointment some time back.
The previous mayor.
That's correct. The previous mayor did. Right. And the Board of Supervisors has yet to find a consensus on their appointee.
And how long has that vacancy been open?
Generally speaking, commissioners are appointed prior to the month of February of this year.
So it's been vacant 2 months?
That's correct.
2 months, okay. And I have the greatest respect for all my colleagues here, Mr. Bell, Mr. Swanson, Mr. Amiano, and Ms. Ma. But I was also looking at how far this issue has gone back. You know, the first person introduced this bill was back in 2004 was my predecessor, the 20th Assembly District, Simone Salinas, AB 2741, and here we are 7 years later, and it's still an issue that seems to not have been worked out on the local level. You know, there's been plenty of time, I guess, for locals to vet it and see if there could be some agreement, but 7 years later, here we are debating the exact same issue. And since then, there's also been some demographic changes, some population growths in these particular areas. And I was looking at the original structure, the original structure, which is trying to reflect the different populations, giving two seats to the larger counties, one seat to the smaller counties. So there's some of that, but it hasn't reflected the changes since this last time this composition was first put together. And so so I understand, you know, that concern as well with the rapidly changed the growths in San Jose and in Oakland as well. And I still think that good partnerships could come about, especially with high-speed rail and other major projects moving forward. But I'm just here wondering, you know, here's this issue, these two issues, major changes that have taken place in terms of the population size, and then also giving the adequate time, 7 years, for local communities to see if they could reach another plan, and that hasn't come about in all this time.
Well, I've been on the commission for 21 years. I served on the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. And each time this debate comes up, the people that the haves are the status quo and the have-nots are blocked by the haves. So if you're in a good position where you get $1 billion for this project and $1 billion for this project and $1 billion for this project because you have a better percentage of the vote, you're not going to want to change it. So you're going to be for the status quo. We got to a point now that the commission, with a very overwhelming majority of the commission, has proposed this legislation. And this legislation has been proposed by the commission. I think it's time for the legislature to accept the fact that we're not going to please everybody, because there are haves. There are haves not. We're talking about transit and transportation dollar allocations, money. And we need to recognize that. Hmm. We need to recognize inequities. So if there are inequities, we should attempt to correct them. And that's the reason.
And I just wanted to also just
for... It's been ongoing for decades.
Okay. And then just for committee members, this bill was already heard in Transportation Commission on March 21st and also had a 13-0 vote on the Transportation Policy Committee.
Mr. Knight.
Well, thank you, Mr. Bell. Let me tell you, it's not uncomfortable because we've been talking about this for 45 minutes. I ran AB 251 last year for the L.A. County MTA, and it was killed in 8 minutes. So that was a lot more uncomfortable, let me tell you. I don't know if a DRNR had anything to do with it, but on the 9 counties that voted, I didn't hear the vote on that.
I can speak for the commission as it is. On the 9 counties that voted, all of the counties eventually supported it. The two commissioners in Contra Costa County needed to get some direction from their home. The Contra Costa County Transportation Authority voted unanimously to support the bill, so I think it's fair to say on Contra Costa their supporters. The commissioner from San Mateo, one abstained. That position has been changed, and another one supported. And then in San Francisco, the commissioners from San Francisco opposed.
Okay. That was about as short as your previous bill, Mr. Knight. So thank you. I appreciate that. Ms. Campos.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And first of all, I want to recognize Mr. Bell for bringing this forward. And I know you served 21 years on the MTC, and I served 10 years on the San Jose City Council dealing with this issue when I was on the VTA. And one of the priorities for the city of San Jose, and probably similar to Oakland, was making sure that we could create a regional transportation system from San Jose to Oakland to San Francisco, and then hopefully go beyond that so that we can get people from point A to point B, from home to work and back and forth. And it didn't get resolved at the local level. And I understand from my colleagues that this might be served as a local issue to be addressed there. But as we move as electeds from the local level to the state level, we still bring those same issues and we still represent the same constituents. And I appreciate the comments that were made by my colleagues for it and against it, and appreciate the people that came to speak for it and against it as well. But the reality is in order for us as a city in San Jose and Santa Clara County to be able to build that infrastructure for the constituents that we represent and the constituents hopefully that will be working in Silicon Valley, we need to move forward with this bill so that we can have a solid voice at the table to move these projects forward and be able to have that bigger vision thinking when we talk about public transportation. Our vision is to be able to bring high-speed rail to our area, to bring BART to our area, and to continue to create housing around our transportation lines. But we can't move this project forward or these project forwards and have that bigger vision unless we're able to have equity at the table. So with that, I would really encourage my colleagues to support this, and I move this bill forward.
We do have a motion and a second. Mr. Norby had a question too as well.
What was the vote? 19 members were present and voting. What was the actual vote?
Off the top of my head, sir, I believe that there was two oppositions and one abstained. And there was, excuse me, yeah, that's correct. And then the rest of the commission voted to support.
Okay, can I have numbers? I need hard numbers.
That'd be 16,
here.
2, and 1.
Off at 16,
16 2, okay. 2, and 1.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Yes.
Okay. You said the Voting Rights Act applies to commissions like this. Is that have any commissions that have had their requests denied by the legislature ever challenged this in court, or is that a possibility, or is that something you're considering?
It's never happened in the past. In the past, with respect to federal statutes, the composition of the commission has been grandfathered in by federal law when they reauthorize their transportation bill, but there's no guarantee that they will continue to do that.
Well, if the Voting Rights Act applied to the U.S. Senate, we'd have a different situation. Unfortunately, that arrangement precedes that. The Dakotas have four senators. California's got one, or two, actually. But this is within our power, and I'm trying to find reasons to vote against this bill, or at least pass, because normally I wouldn't want to interfere with this. But this is a legislative responsibility. The Orange County Transportation Authority, which I sat on for a number of years, was changed by an act of the legislature, and we had a similar situation there. You had two cities, Anaheim and Santa Ana, that wanted their own members, and other cities that were almost as big didn't, but eventually they got them. This does specifically mention San Jose and Oakland, right?
That's correct.
Okay, so it's not a county representative, but it comes from these particular counties, so it does somewhat shift the balance.
Correct.
It doesn't mention the top two next two cities. Now, Oakland is about 400,000. I think the next biggest city is Fremont in the mid-twos. Right. So, I mean, potentially, I don't know if they're ever going to meet, but who knew San Jose would ever surpass San Francisco either long ago. I think it is our responsibility here. This was created by an act of the legislature. I don't know who else can do it. You're not capable of doing this within yourselves, right? Because this was a legislative act
That's correct.
Yeah. So it's hard to refute the numbers. I guess the only way to do it would be to say San Francisco is disproportionately impacted because it has so many more commuters and because of the kind of city that it is. But even with this, it probably will still have representation beyond its actual numbers, as will Oakland, since Oakland's only is less than half as big as San Jose. But you've only got 19 or 21 members, and you've got to do as fair as you can. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Ma.
Thank you very much. And if we are going to really have a debate up here at the legislature, I think we should get all of the delegation members. I mean, I think we've entrusted the locals who attend the MTC meetings. We just got wind of it this week, and that's why we are up here today. I don't know whether the assembly members from Contra Costa, Marin, Napa, the other member from San Mateo, Solano, and Sonoma are all actively engaged in this, and maybe they would like to talk about the composition as well. Napa has 139,000 people, right? San Francisco has 859,000. Well, maybe they would like to be at the table, and maybe they would like to see things change in some way. We are also going through a population shift. The lines are being redrawn, and we're going to have new numbers in August, so I don't know whether these numbers are going to stay the same. And to base, a bill based just on population and not on other factors, perhaps jobs created, number of people using a system. We are building a brand new trans-bay station. I think that members from Alameda as well as Santa Clara are going to be using that system as well. Caltrain stops in San Francisco every day, leaves from San Francisco every day. And so if we're just talking about strict population, I think maybe some of these other cities and counties, maybe we have to kind of revisit it based on a weighted average or some other system and get all the members that are up here who have not been going to the regional meetings, get up here and talk about what is fair, what is equitable, and not just on based on population, but ridership, jobs created, and other factors that we think are very important when we're talking about a transportation system, a transportation plan, allocation of funds, et cetera.
Thank you. That wraps up the questions from the committee. We do have a motion in a second. I would like to let Mr. Bell close on the measure.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Quick, because you've exhausted the debate, but I'd like to point out that all the members of the delegation in the Barry have been contacted early and often about this measure. We now have seven Bay Area Assembly members as co-authors of this bill, and me counting eight. We did have a lot of discussions over the years. I know Mr. Amiano and I have highly respected relationships on the commission and worked to support projects in San Francisco, and he's worked to support projects in other parts of the Bay Area. We've always taken a regional approach. So I think this bill will not endanger or affect that concept of the commission. And I urge your eye vote in the sense that this is a progress towards fairness, and that's a principle I think we can all agree on.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. If the clerk would please call the roll.
Just a comment to explain my vote just very briefly.
Please, because we...
I wasn't necessarily inclined to get involved in this debate or necessarily inclined to support this measure because I think there's a better way of doing it. Nonetheless, I respect the fact that MTC has had a debate on this and has discussed this, and that is very compelling information for me that wasn't shared with me prior. But if MTC thinks this is the most representative way to govern and to provide representation to the people of the Bay Area, I'm going to support this today and hope that you guys can continue to work out a way to create the most representative form of government for all the people of the Bay Area.
Great. All right, let's get the roll going.
The motion is due pass to be re-referred to the Committee on Appropriations. Smythe.
Aye.
Smythe, aye. Alejo.
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford. Campos.
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis. Gordon.
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso.
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight.
Aye.
Knight, aye. Norby.
Aye.
Norby, aye.
That measure is out. Off to appropriations.
Thank you very much, and we're still the world champions.
Go Giants!
By the way, can I? I know this is not necessarily the process, but can I express a yay vote on AB 49? I mean, on AB 484. Just on the record.
Yeah, you can add on. You'll have to add on, though, but yeah, thank you. All right, Mr. Bell, you have another bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and keep the discussion brief. This is AB 129. Under existing law, collecting unpaid fines for property-related code violations are very expensive, time-consuming, and there's a motion and second then. I will urge you an aye vote on this, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
Lizanne Reynolds, Deputy County Counsel for Santa Clara County. This is a part of our continued effort to streamline our code enforcement tools. We're trying to do more with less, and so this amends existing law to help us do that. It expressly allows us to appoint hearing officers to hear appeals of code violations, and also allows us to collect unpaid administrative fines and penalties through the property tax bill system rather than having to go to court and get a judgment lien and wait until they eventually sell the property. So it's just tweaking existing law to help us be more efficient with code enforcement.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other witnesses in support?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Dion Baker representing the California State Association of Counties, also here in support.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, members, Hugh Bauer on behalf of the City of San Marcos. This is very similar to a bill that we sponsored last year, AB 2317. It was a Saldana bill, and we're happy to be in support, and the City of San Marcos joining with Santa Clara County in this year's effort. Thank
Great.
You.
Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition?
Mr. Chairman, members, thank you so much. David Wolf here with the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, and we're opposed to AB 129, much as we were opposed to a similar bill by the author last year. Simply put, we don't believe that local government should be allowed to expand their fine and fee authority in this way. It's not justifiable to us. For the simple reason that, existing litigation processes, including judgment liens, we believe are already sufficient to collect on this without imposing additional fines and fees in terms of special assessments against homeowners who already could be at high risk of foreclosure and have other issues with homeownership. So for those reasons, we'd ask for a no vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition? All right, seeing none, comments, questions from the committee? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second. Mr. Belt?
Yeah, this allows an efficient way of cleaning up nuisance violations in our community. And cleaning up those nuisance violations will lead to better property values, improved assessments, and an improved community. So by having our communities cleaned up more effectively and efficiently, I think we're going to find our public to be happy that their neighbors' homes will be cleaned up if there's code violation, and that the neighbors do not decide to pay their fines. The government should have an operation to collect the fines to remedy that. So this is the purpose of this bill, and I urge an aye vote.
Thank you. Please call the roll.
The motion is due pass. Smythe?
No.
Smythe, no. Alejo?
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford?
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos?
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis? Gordon?
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso?
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight?
No.
Knight, no. Norby?
No.
Norby, no.
The measure is out.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. Next item, I believe, is item number 12, AB 798, from Mr. Chesbro.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. I'll point out for the record that I, even though I represent the northern fringe of the MTC area, I did not take up your time to prolong the hearing on the MTC bill.
Wow. It's greatly noted. That's a
we can add you to that.
See, that's because you're a senator, so you know.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
AB 2166 would authorize the Smith River Rancheria Tribal Council to enter into a joint powers agreement with Crescent City and or Del Norte County. And it also declares the Smith River Rancheria to be a public agency for purposes of that JPA. Smith River Rancheria has had a standing invitation to enter into joint powers agreements with its neighboring local governments, which have been uniquely and universally supported by the community. I want to paint you a picture. This is a small county in the far northwest corner of our state with a fairly small population, but where the tribal governments and the local governments and the business community all work together and strive for common good. And it exists elsewhere, but not to the degree that we have it in this county. And I think it should serve as a model, frankly, for the rest of the state in terms of building for prosperity, having tribes and non-tribal governments working together hand in hand. However, the Joint Powers Act has been interpreted to require federally recognized tribes to obtain legislative authorization to be deemed a public agency for purposes of the act. The most immediate invitation from the county is to join the Border Coast Regional Airport Authority, which was formed in 2007 through the cooperation of Del Norte County, Crescent City, and the Elk Valley Rancheria. Elk Valley Rancheria was previously authorized by legislation, and this bill would allow Smith River Rancheria the same opportunity. This bill passed through the legislature last year and made it to the governor, but was vetoed. I am hopeful that the legislature will view the bill the same way as last year, and that this committee will, and that the new governor will have a different view of the bill. I'm also co-author of Assemblyman Estandi's AB 307, but would like to give Smith River the best chance possible in the eventuality that that bill does not make it to the governor's desk. I think it's very important that this widely supported local effort be able to move forward. As I said, the bill is supported by virtually unanimous local governments and organizations throughout Del Norte County. There is no known opposition, and I would urge your aye vote.
Move the bill.
Okay, we have a bipartisan motion and second, so please keep that in mind in your testimony.
I'll be, Mr. Chairman, committee members, my name's Russ Crabtree. I'm the tribal administrator for Smith River Rancheria. On behalf of my tribal council, my tribal chairperson, Kara Miller, they would like to have been here today, but as it's 7 hours of drive time to get here from Del Norte County. So I bring their greetings, and we would like for an aye vote on this so we can continue our partnerships with and that have been cultivated at the local level. We've been doing this for a lot of years. Smith River Rancheria is unique It addresses its community needs along with its tribal membership needs, and that in partnership brings all together, and we've seen some real benefit come out. And if you're ever in Delaware County, let us give you the tour and show you how we work together with our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Mr. Chairman and members, my name is David Finnegan. I'm a county supervisor for the County of Del Norte. I'm also the chair of the Border Coast Regional Joint Powers Authority, which actually is two states, two counties, two cities, and one present sovereign nation. In Oregon, it is the County of Curry, the City of Brookings. It is the County of Del Norte and the City of Crescent City in California, and Elk Valley Rancheria. Virtually represented is every government that is an economic driver in this area, except for the Smith River Rancheria. And we ask you to pass this bill to allow them to also be there. They are already involved in co-management of the land, the Aboriginal territory surrounding the airport. It only makes sense that they be there as a government representing the economic interests of our community. Thank you.
Thank you. At this point, name,
Mr. Delia. Chairman, members, Josh Pane, on behalf of the Morongo Band of Mission Indians, we're in strong support of this measure. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Anna Kimber. I'm the tribal attorney for Smith River Rancheria, but I'm also representing Scotts Valley Band of Pomo Indians, who have asked me to express support for the bill, as well as the California Association of Tribal Governments. It's an organization that consists of 33 federally recognized tribes here in the state, and we ask for your aye vote.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Dan Baker, representing the California State Association of Counties, also here to lend our support.
Thank you.
Jerome Encinas with California Nations Indian Gaming Association in support.
Frank Molina on behalf of the San Ynez Band of Chumash Indians in support.
Dale Miller, Tribal Chairman, Elk Valley Rancheria in support.
Mr. Chairman, my name is G. Whitehouse. I am Secretary for United Auburn Indian Community, and we are in support of this bill, too.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members, Paul Smith, Regional Council of Rural Counties in support.
Thank you. Any witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, Mr. Chesbrough.
I will just mercifully say I will ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Lejo.
Just a quick question. So AB 307 would be able to allow this to happen on a statewide. This is more focused on your regional, your local area.
Exactly right.
But if that other bill were to pass, it would allow the same to move
Correct.
Forward.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Mr. Norbert.
It's been said, and one of the opposition argument to this is that Indian nations are not really the same as local governments, cities, counties, and it's true that they're not. But at the same time, their internal organization, they do have an electorate, they do have elections. They're not like privately held companies that are owned by individuals. They are associations in that sense, unlike a city or a county where a voting privilege is based on residency as opposed to bloodlines. But that bespeaks to the pre-existing nature of these organizations and of these tribes. So I think while that concern is a legitimate one, I'm persuaded to vote for this because they are governments. They are democratically organized. And in this case, they can be a positive partner in what's being tried to achieve here. So I'll be supporting it.
Thank you. Clerk, please call the roll.
Motion is do pass. Smythe.
Aye.
Smythe, aye. Alejo.
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford.
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos.
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis.
Aye.
Davis, aye. Gordon.
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso.
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight.
Aye.
Knight, aye. Norby.
Aye.
Norby, aye.
Thank you. That measure is out.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Justin, let me say that I know anywhere else in California, it would be called Del Norte.
Exactly.
But in Del Norte, it's Del Norte.
Got it. Mr. Cook, AB 309. That is item number 6.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Again, you have a motion and second from both sides. Please keep that in mind.
All right. In 2010, the Federal Highway Administration suspended four members of a city council in Riverside County from participating in federally funded transportation programs and projects due to criminal indictments of these council members. One of the members of the city council was a city member of the Riverside County Transportation Commission, known as the RCTC, which is charged with coordinating highway and transit planning and identifying projects for state and federal funding. With the suspension of the city council member, RCTC became ineligible to receive any federal funding, which jeopardized millions of dollars anticipated for local projects. By the way, there's 32 members of RCTC, and I have them standing by as witnesses along with all the assembly members of Riverside County to expedite this process. Bad joke. Anyway, luckily the city council member stepped luckily the city council member stepped down from this commission voluntarily. However, if he or any member of the County Transportation Commission or Special Act Agency was suspended by the federal government but refused to step down, that suspended member could remain on the commission, and this would result in perhaps millions of dollars in federal funding, which would be denied. There is no remedy to correct this. The loss could be catastrophic to a region such as Riverside, which has had tremendous economic problems. This corrects it by providing that an appointed individual or ex officio member must vacate his or her position when the individual has been disbarred, suspended, disqualified, or otherwise excluded from participating in federal transactions as prescribed under the federal law. This bill only applies to an appointed or ex officio position that an elected official holds, not the elected office itself. This particular bill passed this 9-0 last year. It went all the way through committee. Had a little problem with the governor, as many of my bills did. He vetoed it, as some people on this committee might have experienced the same evolution. I'm not sure whether he didn't understand the bill or read the info that I had sent him. His veto message had suggested that he believed the bill applied to elective office, and it's not that at all. So I ask for your aye vote. I have two witnesses. I have one witness, Mark Watts from
Mr. Chairman, members, Mark Watts. I'm here on behalf of Riverside County Transportation Commission. We have not taken a position on the measure, but both last year and this year, we provided technical advice to the author's office as he's worked his way through this complicated land of federal disbarment proceedings, and we appreciate his efforts.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Questions? Mr. Cook, you may close.
I ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Please call the roll.
The motion is due pass. Smythe?
Aye.
Smythe, aye. Alejo?
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford?
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos?
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis?
Aye.
Davis, aye. Gordon?
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso?
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight?
Aye.
Knight, aye. Norby?
Aye.
Norby, aye.
The measure is out.
Thank you very much.
Time.
Go Huskies.
That's UConn for everybody not quite sure what he's talking about, but that's what. All right, Ms. Atkins, you are here, so we'll get you going.
Well, thank you very much.
Yes, item number 7, AB 342.
I can see why I miss local government, having watched you for the last hour. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. AB 342 establishes a liaison with the Office of Planning and Research to coordinate with the Department of Defense. As you know, the military has a large presence in California. In fact, the military accounts for nearly $60 billion in direct spending and contracting in our state. And the Department of Defense has had a long history of cooperation when it comes to carrying out the military mission in California. In recent years, through executive order, the Department of Defense has benefited from the creation of a short-term liaison. The executive orders were issued at times when extreme need was called for. While the efforts met with varying levels of success, one thing was clear between all parties. Had they already established a working relationship and understanding of the sensitivities that exist between the state and the Department of Defense, they may have had more expedient and positive results. AB 342 demonstrates the state's commitment to ensuring that the military mission in California is successful. It further shows support for the men and women and families of the military. An issue close to my heart is homelessness, and particularly homelessness among veterans. And I believe that had the liaison been in place prior to BRAC, the base closures, we might have found creative ways to utilize those large resources, find community partners, and create Housing First and opportunities for thousands of homeless veterans in our state. Also, I was actually the acting mayor of San Diego when we went through that BRAC process. We didn't have a state liaison in contact. It was very difficult. So we basically dealt with Washington, D.C. Had we had someone at the state looking out for state interest, I think it would have, we would have been better served. With me today are Ned McKinley of the U.S. Marine. Thank you very much. I will just recognize Ned McKinley of the U.S. Marine Corps and Captain Rick Williamson from Naval Base San Diego and say that we are probably available to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. Any witnesses in support?
Mr. Chairman and members, my name is Captain Rick Williamson. I'm the CEO of Naval Base San Diego, and I'm here on behalf of Rear Admiral Bill French. He's the Commander of Navy Region Southwest. And it's to express the Navy's support for AB 342 by Assemblymember Atkins. California is a critical state to the military, as evidenced by the $59 billion direct contribution to that the military makes to the California economy. Central to this ongoing mission is a strong partnership with California government to ensure issues of mutual concern are successfully considered and resolved. AB 342, through the creation of a military liaison in the Governor's Office of Planning and Research, is a significant step to establish that relationship and will serve us all well. And the Navy urges your support and asks for approval.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair, committee members. My name is Ned McKinley. I'm here on behalf of Major General Anthony Jackson. He's the Commanding General for Marine Corps Installations West. And today I'm actually speaking also on behalf of the Regional Environmental Offices for the Army and the Air Force. And we are all in support of Assembly Bill 342. And just to add a couple of points on to what you've already heard. The first is in the regarding to the wide range of planning challenges that the state is addressing. Many of these can have an impact upon our operations, on our national security mission. It's water supply, renewable energy development, habitat preservation. So all we ask is that our mission get appropriate consideration, and this bill will help make sure that that consideration is given. And then one last point to make is on quality of life issues that periodically come up that affect our service members and affect their families. The PASSER's efforts to protect service members from predatory lending practices, to help the transition of school children of service members between states. And each of these, OPR, maybe a little bit beyond its typical role, but OPR had a key role. And codifying its ongoing role as a military liaison would help make sure it's there in the future. Thank you very much. Ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Anyone, any other witnesses in support? Opposition? Questions from the committee? We do have a motion and a second. Ms. Atkins, if you'd like to close.
Thank you. I would just say that we appreciate the staff at OPR and what they've done to assist local governments in terms of land use planning, guidelines, all of those things. It would be helpful for the military and actually for local government to have a point person they know to call and a position. And I think that is the reason we're bringing this forward. I would ask for your support and an aye vote.
Thank you. Clerk, please call the roll.
The motion is due pass to be referred to the Committee on Appropriations. Smythe.
Aye.
Smythe, aye. Alejo.
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford.
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos.
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis.
Aye.
Davis, aye. Gordon.
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Wesso.
Aye. And I would like to respectfully ask the author if you're to add me as a co-author if you're
Absolutely.
Looking for co-authors.
Thank
I'm sorry.
You.
No problem.
Wesso, aye. Knight.
Aye.
Knight, aye. Norby. Norby,
aye. That measures out 9-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Gatto. Item number one, AB 49.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. So I'm here to present AB 49, which is a permit streamlining bill. I think it's a bill that everybody can agree is necessary. And
you do have witnesses?
I do have some witnesses. You want to go first? Mr. Dunn.
Mr. Chairman, it's a pleasure to be here before your committee on behalf of two clients, American Council of Engineering Companies, also the California Apartment Association. We believe that this is a kind of an easy one. It makes sense to have a opportunity to streamline the process, and we're here in support.
A
Elizabeth Gavrick with the California Association of Realtors. We are here also in support. We believe that the increased certainty in the project approval process and timing is certain to result in a better business climate that will help boost California's economy, and we urge your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members, Tim Coyle representing Apartment Associations of L.A., Santa Barbara, and San Diego in support of the measure, probably long overdue and certainly needed at this time in the state's economy.
Thank you.
Patrick, on behalf of the California State Council of Labor, as I share Mr. Dunn's testimony that this is an easy one. Thank you.
Not that it was a pleasure to be for the committee at the part of the testimony.
That is, of course.
Of course, yeah.
Always a pleasure, just being Mr. Smyth.
It's
implied.
Well, especially for Mr. Dunn. Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Questions of the committee? Mr. Gatto.
I respectfully ask your aye vote.
Thank you. We do have a motion and a second, I believe. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
The motion is due pass and re-refer to the Committee on Natural Resources. Smyth.
Aye.
Smyth, aye. Alejo. Alejo, aye. Bradford.
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos. Campos, aye. Davis.
Aye.
Davis, aye. Gordon.
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso.
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight.
Aye.
Knight, aye. Norby.
Aye.
Norby, aye.
Thank you. Measures up.
Thank you very much.
Welcome, Mr. Trotter. Mr. Wykowski. Item number 15, AB 1086.
Thank you, Chairman Smyth. This legislation will fundamentally change the way local governments function. No, that's not it. This is a county bill. This bill would allow the Alameda County to have a one-time exemption from the 2% transaction and use tax combined rate. The exemption would allow Alameda County Transportation Commission, of which I formerly was a member of, if it so chooses, to place on the countywide transportation sales tax in the November 6, 2012 ballot. To take effect, the ballot measure would need to pass by two-thirds support of the county voters. The reason that this legislation is necessary is two of our cities in Alameda County, San Leandro and Union City, recently enacted citywide sales tax measures that would prevent the countywide tax because it would exceed that 2% cap. So Alameda County has a long history of being a self-help county. We joke, there's no tax measure we don't view favorably. But all joking aside, in 1986, the voters approved the countywide sales tax to improve our transportation systems. That last countywide sales tax measure, which was in 2000, passed with 81% of the vote. So now we've funded our projects that are there, and now we're looking for the next level. These projects are developed during an expenditure plan, and it's our long-range documents that will set the course for the future transportation of Alameda County. The county's overall ability to offer a broad range of transportation options, as you heard during the discussion on AB 57 with MTC, and meet the needs of our diverse population and local businesses, workers, residents, is crucial for our future success. I urge your aye vote, and I will entertain questions.
Thank you.
With me,
I assume you have witnesses.
I have Art Dow, who's the executive director of the Alameda County Transportation Commission.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and member of the committees. Again, my name is Art Dow. I'm the executive director of the Alameda County Transportation Commission, and I'm here to urge you to support AB 1086. Which have been unanimously endorsed by all 14 cities in our county and the two major transit operator. Over the last 25 years, through two separate local transportation sales tax program, we have been able to deliver over $4 billion worth of transportation improvement, not only to our county, but to the Bay Area and to the state of California. Really to not only relieving congestion, but to create jobs and foster economic development. And we are about to go out to our voters once again to extend our current sales tax and possibly to increase our sales tax by another half cent to invest even more in our transportation system throughout the county. We know that we will need two-thirds voters approval. Our recent polling just 2 weeks ago indicated that over 73% of our voters in Alameda County would support another sales tax extension. So we're very happy about that. And AB 1086, 1086 would certainly allow us to place a measure on the ballot that could potentially increase funding for transportation and helping to help ourselves and help the state. So again, we're asking for your aye vote today.
Thank you.
Steve Wallach, just real quick, on behalf of the Alameda Contra Costa Transit District, we're also in support of this bill and urge your aye vote.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition?
Mr. Chairman, you always assume I'm in opposition.
Now, Mr. Wolf, you know that. I just called opposition, you get up. So what am I supposed to think?
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. Members, David Wolf here again with the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. We're opposed to the bill. And simply put, we just we believe it sets a very dangerous precedent to allow counties to expand sales and use tax beyond the current standard of 2%. As we know from 2009 and the state sales tax increases, sales taxes are very regressive, and that tax increase 2 years ago has cost the average California family of four hundreds of additional dollars a year in increased taxation. So we can't justify another regressive tax increase on hardworking families. So for that reason, we'd ask for a no vote. Thank you.
Thank you. So I was right then, Mr. Wolf. You were in opposition.
In this event, yes,
all,
sir.
All right.
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition? Mr. Leo.
Mr. Witkowski. So this would allow you to be able to put something on the ballot for November 2012 next year and let the voters of Alameda decide whether they want this extension to happen or not.
Precisely.
It sounded like we debated that on another issue really recently as well.
It's my understanding that the county already has that authority, but you're looking to exceed the 2% that's in statute. So how much above that 2% are you looking to expand it?
I'm allowing the Alameda County Transportation Commission elected officials to make that decision. I think in practicality, it's no more than a half a cent. I don't think with respect to the opposition, we wouldn't want to go higher than that. But it'll be a one-time, whatever they make the decision.
So you're doing a half percentage point, is that correct? Is that the way I would interpret it? You can go to 2%, you're going 2.5%, or was a half percent, half cent represent?
It's really up to the commission to make the determination. The legislation's tailored to allow them to have a one-time, people do like 3/8, and there's all kinds of numbers in between, but it would be a one-time.
So it's no exemption. Cap, and it's only for a one-year period? Or what's the duration of that?
The duration of the sales tax increase, if our commission choose to make that decision at all,
would be permanent.
It would be either for an for a set period of time, which is our current sales tax measure, have 20 years, or for in perpetuity. Okay. That decision has not been reached. We just want flexibility to go above the cap.
I got it.
Piling on extra sales taxes, I always thought it was a poor way to finance a lot of things, especially transportation where there's no direct nexus. But politically, it's probably the most doable, which is why counties do it. Our county has done it, Orange County, and most counties have. It is highly regressive. It tends to fiscalize land use decisions the more you rely on that sales tax. But people see it as nickels and dimes rather than big money. When you get a bill for a property tax or you get a bill for your income tax or you fill it out, you think that's big money. But if you got a bill for your sales tax at the end of the year, I think people would see it the same way, but they don't. It's nickels and dimes here and there, so it tends to be more politically palatable, and so be it. My understanding is the only reason you have to do this is because the 2% would only be exceeded in Union City, right, one city in this area. It's not that you want to go beyond the 2%. It's that there's that one anomaly, and you have to carve out a district-wide exception to be able to accommodate that, because only in Union City would it exceed the cap. Is that correct?
Well, San Leandro also has passed a local sales tax, so there's two cities in Alameda County. Right. But it does provide that flexibility if the commission decided they just wanted to augment it by a quarter or a cent to meet the schedule that they have for projects. They could do that also. So there's both. They could not augment it now because those cities used up the addition to the cap. No, they were at one and a half, and they used it up.
It might be cumbersome to exclude those cities and exclude them from the transportation benefits.
As tempting as that is, I think it would be difficult.
Right. The cap is a statewide cap. It is statewide law, and I'm hesitant, Mr. Chairman, to make a one-county exception. If we want to look at the overall policy of local option, I think that's fine. People do tend to approve these more than they do at a state level, where it's going into a state general fund, and there's not a lot of control over where it's going. If they see that the projects are actually laid out and it's local, they tend to be more favorable toward them. And the legislature, I think, should be favorable to have that flexibility. And I'm not necessarily against that flexibility, but I'd rather debate the whole reason for the current policy and either make a statewide change or keep it the way it is, as opposed to a county change. Now, you're probably reluctant to ask for that because you figure it's probably less doable.
Well, but I haven't been here 100 days, so I guess my honeymoon is still existing. Yeah. But I thought that at least coming forward with, since I was on the Transportation Commission, and it's a pressing issue now, because if they don't have this authority, while they're making the decision on what to do in 2012, it's timely. Other cities and other counties actually may follow, and I look forward to working with you and other members of the minority party in order to move forward with this flexibility statewide. Mm-hmm. Those are good ideas.
There's a motion and a second. Do you have another follow-up, Mr. Orme?
Well, I'm going to vote no, mostly because of the exception issue. I think it ought to be addressed in terms of a statewide policy. Even though members of my party have been opposed to the governor's current plan to extend taxes or the ballot, I don't think, for speaking for myself, that applies to opposition to all ability of all cities and counties to place similar measures on. That's more of a decision that they have authority over. I have authority where I do. But the 2% is there for a reason. I think we ought to look at that reason before we make an individual exception. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? We do have a motion. Is there a second? There is a second as well. Mr. Wykoski.
I urge your aye vote.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
The motion is do pass and re-refer to the Committee on Revenue and Taxation. Smythe.
No.
Smythe, no. Alejo.
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford.
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos.
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis.
Aye.
Davis, aye. Gordon.
Aye.
Gordon, aye. Hueso.
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight.
No.
Knight, no. Norby.
No.
Norby, no.
That measure is out.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Ma.
Okay, thank you, members. I am back again. Third time is a charm, hopefully. I'm pleased to present AB 485, a bill sponsored by the Bay Area Rapid Transit to facilitate local government funding of transit-oriented development projects. As we all know, we have been talking a lot about RDA. I have been moving this idea to create this tax increment financing zone that does not take money away from local government, but also provides the 20% housing that is also a provision in the RDA. With me today here is Tim Schatz and Paul Fedeli from BART.
Paul Fedeli from BART. Board member Tom Radula was supposed to be here. He couldn't make it. As many of you know, BART for nearly 40 years has been the Bay Area Transit's centerpiece, carrying upwards of 350,000 riders every day, and we've supported Assemblywoman Ma's efforts over the past few years to assist transit-oriented development through infrastructure finance district legislation, because we believe it's important for BART, for our communities that we serve, to have a financial tool to help us enhance our local economies, produce jobs, and assist in our environmental goals through several stations throughout BART, and we are thankful for this. We have the opportunity now to get this and expedite such financing agreements locally. Thank you.
Mr. Chair and members, Tim Schott on behalf of the San Francisco Bay Area Rapid Transit District, just to answer any questions if you have them.
Thank you. Are the witnesses in support?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Gus Corey here on behalf of the California Transit Association. We're in support. I want to echo the comments made by Mr. Fedeli. Also, we think that this is precisely the type of legislation that's necessary in order to stimulate the economy and help chip away at the state's 12% unemployment rate. Every dollar invested in public transportation yields about $6 in economic activity, so we urge your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Scott Haywood from the Santa Clara Valley Transportation Authority, and we would urge your support for the measure. Thank you.
Thank you. Witnesses in opposition.
Mr. Chairman, members, David Wolf here again with the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. We're opposed AB 485. Simply put, we are not in favor of eliminating voter approval on any sort of bond debt, whether to fund public transit facilities or anything else, for the simple reason that any bond debt is going to be passed on to future generations over the course of either 30 or 40 years. And we just believe a higher vote threshold is critical, since taxpayers and voters are going to have to pay off these bonds well after city council members and others who may have put these measures on the ballot leave office. And in addition to, the higher vote threshold is necessary in the event of IFDs for the simple reason that any debt instrument other than a general obligation bond will result in higher interest costs because, unlike a GO bond, it is not secured by the general fund. So for those reasons, we'd ask for your no vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition? Thank you. Mr. Weiso.
Yeah, just the revenue. This is the standard infrastructure financing district model, where the revenue would be taken by the agency that establishes the district. So if it's the city, it would be the city's allocation of the property tax revenue. Is that correct?
Mr. Weiss, my understanding is that only cities or counties can create infrastructure financing mm-hmm. districts, and the revenue is incremental increase in property taxes, not new taxes.
So you can take anybody else's money that wouldn't come from schools, counties, I mean, unless it's the county that's establishing or the city.
There are other districts that receive property tax increments. Those entities would have to elect to opt into this program in order for their funds to be taken. They'd have to pass a resolution in front of their governing board that says they want to play in the transit-oriented development.
But they can opt out?
Yep.
They have a choice.
They have to take an affirmative action for their property tax increment to be diverted for this program.
Okay. So assuming that a school district opted in, would that require the state to backfill those funds?
Pardon me. School districts are prohibited.
Okay. So it would be the county?
The county, but you could have situations where you have a sanitation district, water district, other entities within the that have okay. some piece of the property tax in that infrastructure financing district. They would have to actively opt into the program, or else their increment would continue.
And it wouldn't be a program where the state would have to necessarily backfill those funds.
No.
Okay.
No state implications.
Okay.
In that regard.
I think this is a great program, and just to, I mean, there was a comment made that future generations inherit the debt. But future generations also inherit the infrastructure as well. And I think that's very important to note, that if something is built that benefits everybody, if my children inherit a better transportation system, it's better for everyone. So I support this bill. It's a great bill, and I want to thank the author for bringing it forward.
Thank you. Any other questions from the committee? Seeing none.
I do. Ms. Moss, is this the same bill as last year? That
It's similar. We keep tweaking it every year. My first year, I believe we changed it to expanding the distance from a transit hub from a quarter mile to a half mile. That's now law because people are walking more. And then last year, what was
that's
last
actually year? What we did last year.
Oh, that was last year.
Okay.
All right. Is there a motion on the bill?
Okay.
Is there a second? Did we already? I'm sorry. Thank you. Ms. Ma, you may close.
Thank you. And sorry, Mr. Bradford. So this year, the new provision is the opt-in provision. So that's what's different from last year. But it's pretty similar to other bills I've proposed. And
great. That's your close.
That's respectfully ask for your eye vote, members. Thank you. I think it's important during this time to be able to still continue to provide the infrastructure money that's needed to build the projects, to build that around transit hubs, especially as we are hopefully going to see more transit hubs around the state very soon. So thank you, members.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
The motion is do pass. Smythe.
No.
Smythe, no. Alejo.
Aye.
Alejo, aye. Bradford.
Aye.
Bradford, aye. Campos.
Aye.
Campos, aye. Davis.
Aye.
Davis, aye. Gordon. Hueso.
Aye.
Hueso, aye. Knight.
No.
Knight, no. Norby.
Bill. That measure's up.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Allen. Item number 11, AB 542.
Chairman Smythe, I ask permission to distribute materials. We have a map of the agricultural preserves of Napa County.
Please, just have them to the to our sergeant, and we can distribute them.
AB 42 deals with affordable housing and local control and density adjustments, and it's being sponsored by the Napa County Board of Supervisors. AB 542 addresses the need for rural communities to be able to reasonably meet the regional housing assessment requirements by allowing densities less than those contained in existing law to be deemed appropriate to accommodate housing for lower income households if the site is owned by the planning agency or set aside for affordable housing development, or the planning agency has offered to provide unspecified subsidies on a per unit basis for affordable housing construction. The idea behind this bill is to give Napa County more tools to build affordable housing, not to decrease or prevent it from being built. During the time we've been working on this bill, we've been meeting with the opponents. I am committed to continue working with them because we need to build more affordable housing in our region. Currently, counties must work from default densities that are used to zone for housing. In Napa County, the default density is 20 units per acre. This default density is assigned by the State Department of Housing and Community Development. Much of the land is locked up in the agricultural preserves. Napa County has an unusually large agricultural preserve that was created, I believe, by the voters a number of years ago. The default densities prescribed for Napa County at 20 dwelling units to acre would be completely out of character for Napa County and the unincorporated areas of most counties. When the county has proposed less dense units, on rare occasion, these proposals have been rejected by HCD, which has discretion to accept less than default densities. This inflexibility has resulted in difficulties for the county to attract developers. Having more local control and jurisdiction over densities may, in most cases, assist in attracting developers and help get affordable housing built in these unincorporated areas. I want to stress this. This bill will not result in the counties receiving a lesser assignment of housing units to be built, but it will help make the construction of housing more likely. Today, I have Supervisor Diane Dillon with me from the Napa County Board of Supervisors and Larry Florin, the Director of Housing and Governmental Affairs for the County of Sonoma, and I respectfully request your aye vote.
First witness, please.
Yeah, thank you very much for this opportunity, Diane Dillon from Napa County. What we seek today is flexibility. We're not seeking any reduction in our responsibility or any way of, we're not avoiding that responsibility. We want to fulfill our responsibility to provide affordable housing. I hope most of you have visited Napa County. We are very strong advocates for protecting agricultural land, for having city-centered growth. We're the only county where the agricultural community self-taxes itself to provide farm worker housing. We have financed 883 affordable housing units in the last 20 years for which we received zero credit. And Mr. Florin will go into that. He's from Napa, by the way. We have a standing offer for you to come and see all the things we've done. We want to build affordable housing, but we need this flexibility. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, members. Larry Florin with Napa County. AB 542 is introduced by Assemblymember Michael Allen, will assist jurisdictions such as ours in meeting our RENA obligations as defined under the planning and zoning laws. As most of you are aware, Napa County is a largely rural county which relies on agricultural uses. There are very few sites for a county such as Napa County to identify to meet our regionally established housing needs allocations. We need to be creative when identifying lands that are suitable for housing development. This process has led us in the past to approve and help fund projects of 6 to 8 units per acre for affordable housing. As the committee may be aware, state law establishes for counties such as Napa a default density under which a site is assumed to be suitable to meet its RENA obligations. For our county, the default density is 20 dwelling units to the acre or greater. In preparing a housing element, we conducted a comprehensive inventory of all the lands that were available to the county to program for housing. One such property that we identified was in Angwin, an area outside of St. Helena, California. There is a small college located in Angwin called Pacific Union College. Pacific Union College presented to the county a proposal for developing 380 units of housing on the property that it owned. The college was prepared to dedicate enough land to accommodate 20% of the housing units as affordable, or 76 units of affordable housing. The county has also discussed with the college utilizing local housing funds to help facilitate the development in the site. We included this particular project in the housing element that we submitted to HCD. Despite the fact that this project was a viable project, it was rejected as a viable site by HCD in its review of our housing element. The rationale that was given by the department was that sites of less than 20 dwelling units to the acre cannot be considered as affordable housing sites. The default densities in the law were intended to provide a safe harbor, not to provide an absolute lower limit of density for affordable housing sites. In fact, the law specifically allows cities and counties to provide an analysis showing that a site is suitable for affordable housing, even at lower density. There are numerous examples of successful projects of less than 20 dwelling units to the acre. Many of you are probably aware of Urban Habitat, which has a long track record of building such housing, as well as numerous other examples of self-help housing throughout the state. In our county alone, we have over a half dozen affordable projects of less than 20 dwelling units to the acre. Building projects of higher density in rural areas would, in fact, subject individuals to living in structures that are, in fact, out of character with the surrounding community. Unfortunately, the department has refused to approve lower densities than the default densities, making this provision meaningless. What we are proposing is a change in state law that will allow default densities to be reduced where the local jurisdiction has offered to assist in funding for the project. We've received comments from a number of other counties that are having similar issues, and they support this concern. And I want to reiterate a point that Supervisor Dillon made, that in the past 10 years alone, we have funded over 900 units of affordable housing spending over $16 million of local funds in helping to build affordable housing, including farm worker housing. And in fact, in the last 2 months, we just approved over $5 million in local funding for over 100 units of affordable housing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Okay.
Good afternoon, members. Brian Augusta, on behalf of the California Rural Legal Assistance Foundation. I'd hope to be able to just kind of be somewhat brief about our concerns, but now I think there's been a lot of that's been said so far that has really, I think, cast this bill in a very misleading light. So I'm going to have to unwind some of that. First of all, we live in a state in which we have a tremendous housing crisis, and probably the housing crisis is no greater than for farm workers, who are some of our lowest paid workers in this state. And Napa County produces some world-class wines, but the people who pick those grapes cannot find a place to live in the county of Napa. And I'm not making this up. This is in their report to HCD. During the period covered by the housing element that they're complaining, which HCD has not approved, they have approved or built zero new units that would be of the nature that we're talking about in this bill. They have had some secondary units, granny flats, if you will, three to be precise, that have been constructed, and they purchased some affordability restrictions on some more units. But that is the extent of their progress. And that's probably one reason why HCD is very reluctant to approve a housing element on the promise that low-density land is going to result in affordable housing for farm workers who, as you'll hear in a minute, come and pick the grapes in Napa County and then go elsewhere to live. Now, the problem with this bill is not about HCD, and it's not about some sense of fairness. This is about the densities in state law, which ensure that we can get affordable housing built. Densities which apply to every city and county in the state, of which the vast majority have been able to obtain approval from HCD. Now, the reason we have those default densities is to ensure that they're feasible for the development of affordable housing, because when we do a housing element, it's at the planning stage, right? This is not about units that are being proposed. This is just about bare land and will it support affordable housing. And as some of you know, because you're professionals in the field, to achieve the financial feasibility of affordable housing, you have to have a certain density to get that economy of scale. And that's important to ensure that the public financing that comes after it to help make those units affordable is used in the most efficient way possible. This bill turns it on its head. First of all, it says to HCD, we're taking away your discretion to determine at all whether any density is appropriate. That's exactly what the bill says. It says any density shall be deemed appropriate, as opposed to the default densities. If it's owned by the planning agency or some unspecified, at this point, amount of money is set aside for housing. Well, at the densities that they're talking about, which is about 3 dwelling units to the acre, which is probably a lower density than the single family homes that many of you live in your neighborhoods, at about 3 to 4 dwelling units to the acre, the amount of money that we would need to fill in that blank, I don't think we could come up with it to meet the need for all of the county's arena. So I think the problem for Napa County is that it needs to play by the rules that every other city and county is playing by, make some progress in building some affordable housing, which the units that you're hearing about, the ones that have just been approved, are not to be constructed in the county of Napa. They're to be constructed in a neighboring jurisdiction. So we have a lot of concerns about cutting out a huge hole in the state standards that would apply to every city and county, and instead make special rules for Napa County that eliminate these density standards. So we're committed to working. If there's a proposal that's going to actually produce housing in Napa County, affordable housing, we want to work on that. We don't think this is the approach, and we don't think this is the vehicle for having that further discussion. So we would respectfully ask the committee to hold the bill in the committee.
Thank you. Other witness in.
And I believe there's some copy of his remarks.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm sorry, my respect for everybody. I don't speak very well English because all my life I do the work in the farmer worker, but I want to try to speak the most best. My name is Hector Olvera. I am the chair of the Latinos Unidos del Valle de Napa y Solano. It's a group that work for justice for Latinos farmer workers and other low income people in Napa County and Solano County. And myself was farmer worker in Napa until became disabled. 1.34% of all the people who work in Napa County live in another counties, mostly because there is no affordable housing in Napa County. Most of the thousands of the farmer workers in Napa County had to travel 2 hours per day just to the gate to the and from where they work. That is bad for their health, for their family, if life, and it also very expensive. Farmer workers should have to the same right to the living close to the where they work as everyone else. Napa County has allowed any affordable housing to be building in more than 20 years. No one housing, only for the rich people get to the building houses in Napa County and beautiful wineries. That is discrimination. Affordable housing is good for the economy of the Napa and good for the people. Latinos Unidos has to take the county to the court to to get them to the obedient affordable housing loans. Now they want to you to the chain the loan so they can to continue to keep farmer workers from living in the county who work in the county. This bill will let the county give discrimination against the farmer workers and another low income families. It will allow them to say the farmer workers had to live out in the hills far away from the cities, school, and place where they work. It will market is harder for us to get affordable housing building. Please don't help Napa County to discriminate against the people who work there. Please say no to AB 542. Thank you. E only one say open you have because farmer workers always they had a lot of discrimination. The dream for the farmer workers sometimes is to have enough money for to pay the rent. Thank you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition?
David Grable with the Housing Advocacy Group and Latinos Unidos, urging the committee to hold the bill. We're committed to working with the sponsor. We worked with him before. The 800 units that Mr. Florence speaks about are mostly bunks where farm workers can sleep overnight while they're working in Napa County, but they have to leave their families. Lake County, Solano County, Contra Costa, somewhere else. That's not fair.
Thank you.
Nick Kast, and also with Latinos Unidos, asking for no vote.
Thank you. Committee, Mr. Hueso.
And I want to ask, is this bill specific, would these changes be made specific to Napa County only, or do they extend statewide?
Presently, it's drafted broadly, but I'm very well aware that it may well be attractive to perhaps only rural counties or eventually just to Napa. But we thought we would start out by drafting it broadly.
Okay. And my next question is concerning the housing itself, because I know some arguments have been made that unless the housing is consistent with neighborhood character, it'll probably never be built. There'll be opposition. And there won't be a single agency that would ever support a project that everyone in the surrounding area opposes, and that has always been true of affordable housing. And it's just a matter of reality. And my question to you is, how does this bill, if we're downzoning, and I understand that there were some comments made about economies of scale where the project is more dense. You know, we can finance it easier, but if you reduce the scale, the subsidies increase. Have you thought about whether there's a financing source to fill the gap for projects that are probably going to be more? If you meet the intent of environmental law, which is to be consistent with neighborhood character, the cost of the project goes up. Have you considered that in this equation?
Yes, Larry. You want to speak to that?
Yes, I'm happy to speak to that, Assemblyman. In fact, we just recently committed to funding over 110 units of housing, and our subsidy per unit, in fact, did go up from an average of where it had been previously, $30,000 per unit, up to about $90,000 per unit. But more relevantly, and on point on your question, is in fact, of the 16 projects that were approved by Napa County previously, of them, a quick eyeballing of them, two-thirds of them were less than 20 dwelling units to the acre. In fact, most of them were in the 6 to 20 dwelling units to the acre, which is, in fact, what the character of our county is. And, in fact, there was sufficient economy in those for those to actually get built.
Okay, so, and that's still, I mean, in the city areas, we're building probably 32 units per acre, maybe up to 35, but I understand that Napa is different, and it's unique, and it's a tourist attraction, and anything you do to take away from the tourist economy will hurt everybody, farm workers and growers and everyone else. I understand that. That's why I'm keeping an open eye on this and also an open mind to make sure that we meet our targets of creating the housing. It's very important that farm workers not be separated from the general population, that they have an opportunity to live in the nice parts of town as well. I want to make sure that if we support this, that it will be with that intent in mind. I know that's very hard to achieve as well, but if we can meet the design guidelines of the community and the neighborhood character challenge, if we can meet that and still make sure we integrate farm workers with the rest of the community, because their children deserve to go to the good schools too and to be close to the nice parts of town. And I just want to hear your comments about that, if this legislation would not curtail farm worker housing from being located in the nice parts of Napa as well.
Well, if I can give you an example, the small community that was mentioned previously, Angwin, which is unincorporated and therefore, you know, outside the cities and one of the few areas where we have a place where we could designate for affordable housing in a community with a school, with a grocery store. I think the highest density there right now is 4 units to the acre. And this was that we had a site that was previously approved for 12 units to the acre in our previous housing cycle, approved by HCD. And then we had this change in law with the default to 20. Mm-hmm. And there's no way that community would accept a 20 unit to the acre project. It's just when the biggest thing going on is 3 to 4 units per acre. Most of the places that you would think of when you think of Napa, where there is wealthy housing or nice housing, are in the cities. We don't have sites where we have water and wastewater services available for affordable housing units to be built. So we have to, Angwin is one of our few places. We just don't have very many locations, and they are in places where there is very low density right now.
Is it possible to work on, if you were to provide some evidence of a funding source to fill the gap of some of these projects, that would be very helpful. I'd be more comfortable in supporting it if it was geared around Napa itself. I think there are different dynamics in different counties. I'd like to see that. I want to move the bill and hopefully move it forward and encourage the author to provide some evidence that Napa is working on gap financing for affordable housing projects, and that the plans are at the local level. We'll make a commitment, as you have mentioned, to locate these. Just because we're not building higher density projects doesn't mean we're not building high quality projects. Mm-hmm. And I know farm workers would much rather live in units that look much more like the surrounding community as well. But it's very important that we make a commitment to provide this housing. I actually went to Napa and visited some affordable housing sites, and they're very high quality. But, there's a lot of traffic in Napa as well. And it's not good for the economy to have people in gridlock in rural areas. So we have to do something about making sure workers can live in the county that they work in. So
thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My question is kind of like following along the lines of Mr. Weso, and in all my years in local government, I never knew where affordable housing would pencil out by reducing the density. It was always developers who were coming in asking for a greater density in order for it to pencil out and make it truly affordable. So to me, I just don't know how that becomes affordable once you change that dynamic. And it's my understanding under current state law that exemption is already in place to come before HCD and request a reduction in density if it's justified. So as I look at the floor area ratio and you talk about penciling it out, why couldn't you just go before HCD and ask for that exemption? Because I am too concerned that it changes state law and it's not specific enough to Napa, so it affects everyone. And I think would this lead to a reduction in overall affordable housing in the state of California?
With all due respect, you've asked me a somewhat legal question to which I don't know the answer.
I only play attorney here, though. But, yeah.
Assembly Member, we did, in fact, approach HCD. And, in fact, with a actual viable project. In fact, I bring the project plans with you that show how the economics on this particular project would work. It was, in our estimation and in our outside financial consultants' estimation, a financially viable project, and it was, in fact, at 8 dwelling units to the acre. We did include the project in the housing element. Unfortunately, HCD deemed it an unacceptable site. And when we went back and asked them for an explanation, they simply said anything under 20 dwelling units to the acre is not an acceptable site. So while they have the authority to do that, they're simply not exercising that authority. And in fact, what we have is a very real-world project with, as I think I mentioned earlier, 40 units of affordable housing, and we simply did not get credit for that.
So I guess my question, would this lead to a reduction in overall affordable housing in the state of California? If you keep displacing and you don't build it in the community in which you currently reside or represent, where's that housing pushed to?
We don't believe it would actually end up with a reduction. Certainly, we can only speak for our county. I'm not going to profess to be an expert on the state of California, but I'll tell you, in our county, it would, in fact, we think, encourage more affordable housing to be built in the county. And, in fact, what the form of the housing that you will have will be consistent with the housing that's adjacent to it. So if we take the Angwin example again, if you were to build 20 dwelling units to the acre there, you'd be looking at very, very dense housing in a community that has mostly single-family units. And in fact, as was mentioned previously, the community probably wouldn't support that and would, in fact, fight that. So we think it is more likely that housing, affordable housing units would be approved if, in fact, they were in character with the surrounding community, which, in fact, it would be in this case.
My last comment, I'm familiar with a project in the county of L.A. where I reside where, let's say, a more affluent community built their affordable housing in the city next door. They got the credit, but they never built it in their communities, and it's kind of like pushing it, saying, not in my backyard. So how is that different from that situation where you sell your credits or get the credit, but you still don't necessarily meet your obligation of building affordable housing either in your city or in your county?
Actually, it's a very good question. And as you may be aware, the state law currently allows for counties to partner with cities to form what's called a subregion, where we determine within our county jurisdiction where the housing would most appropriately be built, whether in cities or in the counties. And in fact, Napa County has entered into such an agreement with our cities so that we can conduct such a comprehensive review to determine the most appropriate places for the housing to be built. We're not going to be transferring any of those units outside of the county limits. In fact, they will still be contained within the county of Napa. They may, in fact, be contained within cities where we believe the services are most appropriate, where the infrastructure is actually provided. And we would, in fact, that's what we have a history of, is providing funding for building housing in those areas.
Thank you very much. First of all, I just wanted to say I have the highest respect for my good colleague, Michael Allen. I think he's a great representative for Napa, and I know he's very sensitive to this issue, just as I am. Affordable housing was key in our community, and it was very complicated. And I used to represent low-income families as a legal aid worker. And we dealt specifically when counties didn't want to build affordable housing to do their fair share, to meet the RENA numbers, so that they're equally planning and zoning for affordable housing in all parts of the county so that it's equitable and that counties don't just shift affordable housing to only a particular area while everywhere else is not doing their part. And unfortunately, then some counties, it took litigation to have them comply by state law. But certainly, as the law currently reads, every area, and there's different categories for rural, suburban, depending on what your composition is, HCD creates those numbers deemed appropriate to construct affordable housing. And in my community, down in the Pajaro Valley, we have a similar issue. We're surrounded by prime agricultural land and richest agricultural areas in the state. And so our community had to kind of come to grips with how it wanted to deal with its affordable housing, how to meet the needs of our local workforce, including our farm worker population, but also using the limited lands that are available to maximize those so that we're able to make the most affordable housing in the limited land and limit urban sprawl. And so that's a very key concern. I'm sure it's a big concern in your area. And I remember 15 years ago looking at a documentary about Napa, and it was talking about the very same thing these gentlemen were talking about here today, that it's one of the richest wine-growing areas in the world. But yet, at that point, this documentary was documenting a lot of farm workers living out in the street. And there was a featured church that was providing housing, and then there was a story shortly after that they were trying to provide yurts and outside the city limits to deal with the farm worker population rather than building affordable housing. So I've kind of followed what has happened in Napa all these years, but I do have some major concerns with this bill because it has implications for the entire state, not just for Napa. And I just had a couple of questions. One was how long, I know your housing element wasn't certified in 2009, but before 2009, how long has Napa gone without a certified housing element by HCD?
Our last housing element was certified in 2004, early 2005, the one that's for the cycle from 2000 to 2007. It's the current one that was not certified. I'm sorry.
And what have you done since then? Since
we believe that we have identified valid sites, and so we're engaged. We've been sued, as is allowed to have happen when you don't have a certified housing element. And we're defending the sites that we've identified as being good sites that should allow us to have a certified housing element.
And the bill doesn't specify. It's very vague. According to you, what do you think are the lower levels that you deem appropriate for building affordable housing in terms of density per acre?
It would depend on the place as to what was appropriate. I think if you look at the map that was passed out, we have these islands in a vast amount of green that are our cities. Those cities do not extend water or sewer service outside of them. So the county as an entity is very strapped to find places where we can put affordable housing. And that has helped determine the limited number of sites we've been able to identify. Otherwise, I'm sure you would acknowledge that it is impossible to afford to build affordable housing if you also have to put in all the infrastructure. So what we tried to do was identify places where there's already existing infrastructure, and we would then ask that there be appropriate densities to those areas, wherever they might be. And it varies from site to site in the sites that we've identified. Larry's the guy carrying the numbers around in his head, so he could identify
so
f- that.
How far behind are you in terms of meeting your RENA numbers for affordable workforce housing since 2009? How many units have you built over the years?
Well, in 2009, we have actually funded and entered into agreements to receive transfers from some of the local jurisdictions. So in that sense, we actually just opened in Yountville a housing development project of 25 units, and we have in fact entered into agreements for transferring RENA units and funded an additional 110 units of housing, and we have under construction a self-help project right now in the city of Napa again of almost 30 units.